evening, friends. Today we are going to look at one of the most beautiful things ever created in this entire world. Am I talking about my child? No. True as it may be, I'm talking about this issue of Nintendo Power, the official player's guide for Mario 3. Is this not absolutely stunningly beautiful? This came out shortly after... probably. The game came out in February of 1990, so this would have been out shortly afterward. I can't imagine a person receiving this in the mail and not being completely floored. It cost $3.50 at the time. I got this one for $10. Actually, maybe, yeah, for $10. It's a little beaten up, as you can see, but it's still beautiful and still perfect in every way. So let's dive right in. So as you can see, this guide is a little beaten up. It's not in the best of quality. It's got some frayed edges here. The cover's a little bit crumpled. It's obviously a well-loved document, or perhaps a well-neglected document. So we can see on the cover here, let's take a look at the cover. We've got Bowser and the Koopa kids. They're all descending this hill. We've got Mario in his raccoon outfit. We've got the official Nintendo Seal of Power. We've got 84 pages of maps, tactics, and power plays. Whoa, whoa, whoa. This is officially Nintendo Power number 13. I can imagine that when people got this thing in the mail, they absolutely lost their minds because it's so amazing and perfect in every way. Let's open her up. Beep-a-da-boop-a-beep. So this really beautiful, subtle little image in the corner of the airship and the Koopalings. The anchor's just kind of swinging here. You've got Roy throwing a wrench seemingly at nothing. Maybe he's just mad. I like that Bowser's on the front here. I can't remember what this thing is called, the thing in the front of a ship. Anyway, I'll figure it out. Ludwig's shooting a cannonball. Over here we have the table of contents and the copyright information. Let's see. This guide is broken up into basic moves, power-up and magical items, advanced moves, unlimited one-up techniques, Mario's foes, which is one of the best parts, and matching game and world data box. This is the part that you would be referencing a lot when you're playing this game because those mini-games are so frustrating to not be able to do. So... let's see, who did the illustration on this? Makikazu Omori and Hideaki Ito. I'm sure I said those really poorly and just absolutely butchered them, but I don't know much about Japanese. So here we go. We've got all of Mario's basic moves. We've got walking, jumping out of the water, squatting, stomping, tail attack, smash it up. I believe that means hitting someone from underneath a block. Climbing, acceleration, super jump. Ah, yes, if you hold down the button while jumping on an enemy, you get a little boost. Flying or floating, sliding, picking up and kicking, swimming, going down pipes and entering doors. Now, this was very, very, what's the word I'm looking for? This was such an expansion on Mario's previous skill set, because, you know, a few of these were in the first Mario game and the second Mario game, but this just really expanded on his powers, and it was really exciting time to be in, you know, when this game was around first. Here we've got Mario's various outfits. Standard Mario, Raccoon Mario, which you get from getting the leaf. Frog Mario swims underwater very quickly. Tanuki Mario. I don't think I knew anyone at the time who knew what a Tanuki was. I don't know a single person who could tell you what a Tanuki was at the time this came out. The internet didn't exist.
I don't think any of us would have known to look up red, like Asian red panda. But anyway, it's such a popular little creature, just this little mammal. It's a big part of Japanese folklore, but it doesn't have much to do with America. So we just thought it was a full raccoon suit. We just thought tanuki was just a word. We didn't know what it meant. Standard Fire Mario. You know, pick up that fire flower, get them fireballs. And Hammer Suit Mario. This was the best suit in the game. This was hands down the best item in the game. God, I think you can only find it in like a couple places. And it's just so freaking good. But I don't know, if you're a noob like me, you probably lost it all the time. So, moving on. Some more items. Star for invincibility. The P Wing. I believe its actual name is the Power Wing, but everyone I knew called it the P Wing, and this thing is great. Man, you could just spam through all those later levels with this thing. It was so good. Jugum's Cloud. That is Lakitu's name, his proper name, I think, in Japanese. So this is Lakitu's Cloud, but most of us, when we were kids, we had no idea what Jugum was. We're like, what is Jugum? The hammer for breaking through bricks, and one specifically in the desert world that gets you the warp whistle. Typical green one-up mushroom. The anchor, which stops the Koopaling's ship from escaping. I don't really know anybody who's used this, but I think in World 7 it would have been useful. The magic whistles, three little delights, and the music box, which puts the Hammer Brother to sleep. But I don't know anyone who wanted to get rid of the Hammer Brothers because they have good items, and you want those items. I'm moving on. Oh God, this poor book is like it's coming apart at the seams here. I'm probably just gonna end up having to destroy the binding and storing this thing later, maybe in some like plastic sheets or something like that, because this poor thing is just falling apart. Advanced moves. We're not really gonna go over this. Let's go on. Yes. One-up techniques. So, oscillating Koopa, what does that mean? Oh, that's when you kick a Koopa shell through enough guys to get a one up. The Goomba Stomp, where you jump on enough people to get a one up. These are all holdovers from the first Mario game. These existed there too. Multiple one up 200 coin stages. Just enter one of these stages and you'll just get a bunch of money. The Vine Method. I see. I guess if you touch a vine, it doesn't count as hitting the ground. So as long as you have a vine, you can keep hitting that Koopa shell. Because the game doesn't believe you've left the air. Mario's foes. Look at this beautiful, beautiful spread. Look at these beautiful, beautiful pictures. Aren't they just gorgeous? Aren't they just phenomenal? I mean, really, look at that. Just soak that all in. We didn't have a lot of stuff like this when we were kids. We just didn't. You had the instruction manuals, but this full spread of every enemy was just astounding. Really, just so inspiring and so beautiful. Let's go over some of these bad guys. You've got your typical red Koopa Troopa, your green Koopa Troopa. Red Koopa Paratroopa, red Koopa Paratroopa, green Koopa Paratroopa, green Koopa Red Giant Koopa Troopa, green Gargantuan Koopa Troopa. These guys are in stage 4, the giant level. Colossal Koopa Paratroopa. Oh my goodness. Dry Bones. These guys were real cool when you first met them. The fact that you can't kill them except with a star. No, wait. Can you kill them with a raccoon tail? Maybe. Anyway. Buzzy Beetle, he's been around since the beginning. Bloopers, love bloopers, or as they were originally called, Bloobers. Buster Beetle, this guy's such a jerk. He just throws bricks at you. I love Parabeetles because I love the way that they kind of dip when you jump on them. I like that they kind of have to compensate for gravity. Blooper Nanny, these are real fun to watch because of the way that the babies trail behind them. Spiny, an old classic. Piranha Plant, another classic. Venus Fire Trap. I can't play this game without thinking about these guys and ducking down next to the shell to get away from that fireball. Hanging piranha plants. I believe these began in the Japanese version of Mario 2, aka The Lost Levels. Piranha giganticus. Oh, sorry. Piranhacus giganticus. Patooie. I love this guy. He just kind of sits there and breathes hard enough for that spiky ball to float above his head. It's real fun, just this little walking plant with this big spiky ball. Visually, it's a very appealing enemy. Nipper plant, these little sharks. It's hard to jump on them if they bite at you. Munchers. I'd say these are probably the most enigmatic enemy in the game, because what the heck are they? I know they're plants, but like, they're so brutal. Where did these things come from? What is their history? I know some game designer just thought of them, but still, like, I want the lore. Muncher lore. Little Goomba, these little jerks that climb all over you. Oh, no, wait. That's the Micro Mugger Goomba. The Little Goomba. I love that name, Little Goomba. Or in Japanese, Kuribo. These are just the... I don't know which depiction I like more, the original Mario, like the dark brown version, or these kind of orange ones. They both have a lot of personality. Paragoombas, very cool. Paragoombas with micro Goombas. The Grand Goomba, the big boy. Scoot, scoot. These guys are fun to stomp. Pile driver micro Goombas. Oh, these guys are such a pain in the butt. Kuribo's Goomba. Or I guess translated Goomba's Goomba. That boot. I love that boot. 5-3 forever. Never leaves our hearts. Cheap Cheeps. Another classic. Boss. Bass. This is the most terrifying level in the entire game. God help you if this guy eats you. Oh, I love running away from that big boss bass. Let's go over to this page. Spiky Cheep Cheep. Big Bertha, who has the little fish hide in its mouth. That little guy there, the baby cheap. What a cutie pie. Hammer Bros, classic. Boomerang Bros, way more fun to kill. Fire Bros, cool red. I like how red they are, and I like their gear. Lakitu since the very beginning. Spiny Eggs. Sledge Bros, these guys make the ground shake. Thwomp Trap, or as they're more colloquial known, just the Thwomp. This is the coolest design of any enemy in this game. I love Thwomps so much. I love them forever. Thwomps live in my heart. Podoboo, the little living fireballs. Jellectro. Surely the inspiration for the jellyfish scene in Finding Nemo. Fire Snake. God, so annoying. Fire Chomp, even more annoying, especially in the auto-scrolling sky stage that you find him in. I know I said Thwomp is the coolest, but Chain Chomp is also the coolest. So many, oh god, so many of the best Mario characters came from this game. I love Chain Chomp. I love Chain Chomp. Ba-Bomb, a classic since Mario 2. Spike, another very cool guy. Just barfs that big ball up and throws it at your face. Rotodisc. More of a trap than an enemy. The Angry Sun. We all love the Angry Sun, who does little loop-de-loops and chases you around in the desert. A Lava Lotus, a sort of a callback to, there's an enemy like this in Mario 2 who lives on the land. Rocky Ranch. I love Rocky Ranch. I always thought they were Molsa, but apparently they're Koopas. They're just Koopas that live in little holes, I guess. Boo Diddley. I didn't even remember that he had a last name. I thought he was just Boo. Hotfoot. Probably the most uncreative enemy in the game. Just a fire with feet. I mean, I guess this one's still better than the Podoboo. It's like a walking Podoboo. Stretch. You don't see much of these guys anymore. Boo as furniture. Bullet Bill. Bullet Bill, we all know Bullet Bill. Missile Bill, a new addition. Rocket engines, which are just, you know, rocket engines. Boom Boom, what a cool guy. I love Boom Boom. He's so cool to stomp on. And I like how he gets a little harder each time you step on him. Here are the Koopalings. Oh, yes. Oh, yes, the Koopalings. Bowser's children, so I thought. I thought they were Bowser's children. But I think that was retconned. Now they're just like a Bowser. I guess they're in his care. Larry. Who's usually the leader of the group. And also the youngest, apparently. Morton, he's got a ground stomp and a cool unibrow. Wendy, the only girl Koopaling. She throws rings at you. Iggy, named after Iggy Pop. He's sort of the weird one, I think. Or maybe just the nervous one, I don't know. Roy Koopa, surely the coolest cat in the whole bunch. He's also got a ground stomp like Morton. Lemmy Koopa, who rides around on a ball. He's like the wackiest of the group. I guess Iggy's the nerd and Lemmy's like the goofy one. And then my personal favorite, Ludwig von Koopa. He's the older brother. He's got a wicked haircut. And then, of course, Bowser, the Koopa King. Bowser doesn't really get recognized as the Koopa King very often these days. You don't hear his name used in such a way. He just goes by old Bowser. Or, as Mario 64 would have you know, me old Bowsy. Ah, look at this page. It's just coming right out. Mario's matching game. This is one of the most valuable resources in this entire book. Because you land on one of these floating N cards. I don't know what the N is for. Is it for Nintendo? And you get to play a matching game and get this this stuff here. And knowing this meant that you could just max out your items. What a great thing to have. I don't remember how we came to acquire this book when we were younger, but we did have a copy of it. And oh, so useful. And here they let you know about some other ways that you can get items from these Hammer Brothers that wander around the world map. From a toad house or the magic white mushroom house. I think this only appears once or twice in the game. So here we get into one of the best parts of this whole thing. This official art for each world. I absolutely love, love, love this art. I love this art. Look at how great that Grassland World 1 image is. Look at that. You've got this really upset Goomba. What happened to me? I'm getting owned. You got this Koopa. I, too, am getting owned. Oh, no. You got this little trail of dust as each one's bumbling around. You've got this Paragoomba dropping his mini Micro Goombas. You've got this Fire Piranha plant shooting fireballs. Mario's just dodging them all. What a hero. Open up. Here we have a guide that gets you through each world. It lets you know where all the secrets are, like all the cool coins and stuff. This one up here in the sky. Really, having that raccoon tail opened up so many possibilities for this game. You could really just go anywhere. Like, and there's something kind of magical about Mario disappearing off screen. You know he's flying around up there, but you don't know where he is, and you don't know when he's coming down. Here we have the clue to the first warp whistle. You duck behind this white block here. You pop down to the bottom, and you're behind the scenery. Which, by the way, let's talk about this. Miyamoto confirmed that Mario 3 didn't actually happen as like a real event. It was all a stage play that everybody put on, which is so bizarre to me. It's almost like after the first Mario, nothing was real. So you got this, he's either on vacation or he's just goofing around, like dreaming or in a play. It's so funny. But anyway, you go behind the stage, and there's that warp whistle. Here we get a taste of some underground action. in this stage, you encounter the there's this they remix. They do like a cool remix, like a very hip remix of the sewer theme for these levels where you're going underground, and it's real catchy and real good. If you don't know that theme, go listen to it. It's real cool. Here's the first fortress. Did they give the tip? Yes. Boom Boom has a second whistle in this fortress. In this fortress, there's a place right here where you stop on a dry bones, then you use your leaf to run back and forth to build up your P meter. And once that P meter is up, you go above the ceiling over into the next room, and there's the whistle. And this tip, I don't know if it was, it was either this one or the other one that are showcased in the movie The Wizard, which is a really cool idea by Nintendo to kind of let you know like where a secret was using a movie, even if the movie did kind of suck and was just one big ad. So, moving on. Here we have the first airship. What is it about airships in video games? There's something about airships that are just so compelling. It's this idea that like planes just aren't in fashion in a lot of the best games and the best franchises, like Final Fantasy, all about airships. Super Mario Brothers, all about airships. In Final Fantasy, they're just really a mode of transportation, but in Mario, it's like a whole level. I mean, imagine this giant contraption up in the sky. How is it even possible? It's just a pile of logs. A pile of logs and a bunch of jet fuel. My God. Bowser must not care if those Koopalings die. Here we have the king of each kingdom has been transformed by Bowser's magic, and you have to return their wand to break the curse. And so each king starts off as a different creature. This one is a dog scratching his fleas. And at the end of each one of these levels, you get a letter from Princess Toadstool. Yes, she's still Princess Toadstool. You get a letter from Princess Toadstool letting you know her status and what you should avoid in the next area, or like a little hint. Some of them are kind of mixed up. And you get a gift, or as she calls it, I think she calls it a jewel? I don't know why she calls it a jewel. But yeah, she clears a jewel to protect you, and it's a P-Wing. Thank God. Here we are going into World 2, which is the Kupari Desert. That's cute. I thought it was called Desert Land, but it's the Kupari Desert, apparently. Here's the little guide that tells you where various items are. Here is the secret path to the third whistle, and this cool little irrigation channel dug into the symbol of the Roman numeral 3 from Mario Brothers 3. Isn't that fun? So let's look at that beautiful, beautiful, beautiful World 2 game art. You've got that hopping fire snake. You've got Mario jumping over him, shooting a fireball at this mini Goomba. And there's that cool angry sun. You also got some pyramids in the background, which makes you wonder, did pharaohs once live in this land? Had to pause there for a second. My wife got me a big old cherry limeade. I love a big old cherry limeade. Anyway, continuing. So let's dive into World 2. Oops. Oh my goodness. So this level is really frustrating because you've got these fire snakes hopping all over the place. You've got these purple pipes that are kind of hard to get into. And I've never really felt like I've mastered this stage. And I never really loved this stage. And then over here you got this little thing where there's like a little hopping guy or anything that kind of surprises you. I don't know. I don't know. 2-1. 2-1, not my favorite. 2-2. This is another weird one because you've got this big oasis here, and you hit a power block, and all these coins turn into bricks, and all the bricks turn into coins. But I never end up making it through to the end. I always just end up falling in the water, which is I don't love it. Your reward is an anchor. What happens? Where do you get that anchor? I don't know. Anyway, they're showing a toad house with an anchor. Oh, here's the fortress world. Let's see. The World 2 fortress has Thwomps in it. This is the first time that Thwomps appear. I don't think they're in the World 1 fortress. Correct me if I'm wrong. Yeah, there's no Thwomps in here. But this one, you got all these Thwomps, and these guys are so cool. You pass under them, they get mad, and then they just smash you to pieces. Love me a good Thwomp. There's a little tip on how to trick them. You just kind of trigger them by getting close, and then when they start going back up, that's when you sneak past them. Mario knows diddly. Come on, guys, come on. Enough with the puns. If you turn your back on Boo Diddly, he'll chase you. But if you face him, he'll stay put. And then you beat another boom boom and you're all done. Oh, whoa. This part here. The descending ceiling of spikes. Man, that's stressful. Here's a little guide. On how to use the warp whistles. Where you'll go if you use one. World 2-8, Riches of the Pyramids. Oh yeah, there's a P-block way up there, and if you hit it, these all turn to coins. That's real cool. Oh, and this is so fun. You hit this little turtle, and he just, right here. You hit this Koopa, and he just goes bouncing back and forth, knocking all those blocks to pieces. Really fun. There's so much stuff in here that was so cool the first time we encountered it. I really love it. Oh, the World 2 Desert. See this here? This is where that angry sun gets you. There's a tornado you have to pass by, like, running through it really, really fast. And once you get past that tornado, I'm sorry, whirlwind, that's when you have to beat the angry sun all the way to the end. And that is a real cool level, because I think the first time I encountered that, we were not expecting that sun to come after us. World 2-4. Oh, this level is real nice. This level is beautiful. This is the first time you encounter the chain chomp, I think, which is another stressful moment. But I love all these palm trees up here. I love the multiple layers to this level. This big above ground pool or whatever this is oasis. And there's a little boomerang brother hanging out near the end. This level is gorgeous, and it really feels, it feels different from every other level in this area. It's more peaceful for some reason, even though it's not any easier. Oh wait, was I mistaken? Do you first encounter the chain chomp in 2-5? Maybe I was mistaken. I thought there was one in here. I could have sworn there was one, like, right in the beginning, but maybe I'm wrong. I guess I'm not right. I guess this is where you first encounter the chain chomp. It's a similarly style level to the last one. Oh, look at that rude dude. He's biting the frame. He's breaking the fourth wall there. Oh, what's all this? Oh, the pyramid. The pyramid is really cool. Because it's just sort of on the map as a pyramid. It doesn't have one of those little stage markers. It's just a straight-up pyramid, which is really neat. There's a lot of beetles in here, a lot of buzzy beetles, which they've illustrated over here. Mario's trying to run away because they climb around on the ceiling and fall down and spin breakdancer style on their shells. And here's the last whistle, Beyond the Sand Dune. You break this block using the hammer you got earlier in this world. You fight, I think, a pair of fire bros, and then you get that last whistle. Now, this is a point where a lot of people who are just trying to get through the game tap out and go to the last world. But there's a second air fortress and the battle with Morton. This king has been transformed into a spider, and when you beat Morton and get the wand back, or the scepter back, sorry, the princess gives you a Jugum's cloud. see World 3 water level art, also known as Island World. Apparently, I thought it was called Water World, but it's Island World. You've got Big Bertha with the mini cheap. You've got the Jelectro. You've got that Lotus down there. You got your Cheep Cheep, which is green here. And you've got the blooper with the nanny blooper with the little squadron of mini bloopers. Here's a fun thing. They talk about this in the Mario Encyclopedia. This little secret area here is supposed to be shaped like Japan. These are the four major islands. Isn't that neat? That's pretty neat. That's pretty special. So, World 3 is... There's something... It's a stressful level because you're constantly being chased around by this giant fish that can eat you. In several of the stages. And, I don't know, it's a little more stressful than the previous two worlds. The underwater levels are, they're more hazardous than the ones in Mario 1. There's a lot more that can get you. Yeah, that sentiment is here. Not for the faint of heart. I love this picture of Mario holding open Big Bertha's maw with a stick that's breaking. Look out, buddy. Here he is in the frog suit. Swimming around again. Ooh, the water fortress. This one's tough. What else? I guess there's not much to say. Oh, this is the water fortress. Are there two fortresses? What's going on here? Yeah, I guess there are two. So this one's got a lot of like door puzzles in it, which is really frustrating. And this one's flooded, it says. So I guess this entire fortress is full of water. Wow, two fortresses. Here's Stretch. You meet Stretch for the first time. Tidal Terror. Oh, yes. In this one, the water level keeps rising and falling. And that is when Boss Bass will jump out and eat you. And man, that is so stressful. This is a dual level above water and below water. A lot of pipe action in and out. How to turn a wandering hammer brother into a treasure ship. Ooh, what? Collect a number of coins that's a multiple of 11. Make the 10 digit in your score match the multiple of 11. Stop the timer at the end of the stage on an even number. One possible combination would be 11 coins. Score 9,310. Timer 104. What the heck? This only works in worlds 1, 3, 5, and 6. Wow. I feel like this has happened to me just a few times by accident. Look at that treasure ship. That's so cool. I forgot about that. Oh man, that's great. That is great. Here is the third airship. Ooh, don't you love that yellow sky? Don't you love that? That's so rich. Is it yellow in the game? There's not a lot of good yellow. It's more like a mustard color, so I guess in the blue painted wood. And there's Wendy, who throws these big rings at you. The king in this world has been transformed into a kappa, or a spike maybe? I don't know. He looks like a kappa. And your reward for rescuing that king is a music box. Giant world. What a great concept. Oh, this was so much fun. This was such a neat surprise back in the day. because you're little. You're either very small or they're very big, but everyone's huge. Everything is oversized, these giant sprites. And I think that's accomplished by making each one a composite of four sprites. I don't know anything about video game programs, so don't pay attention to me. Ooh, ooh. What is that? Get 22 coins and the White House will appear. Act fast and collect coins after you hit the switch block. You'll get Starman. It will be easier to collect all 22. And you get this White House with an anchor inside, which you can use to pin down the airship. Say hi to the Sledge Brothers. Those guys are cool. If you're on the ground when they hit you, you're temporarily stuck. Now, I believe this underground part here does not have any giant enemies in it. I believe that's all above ground stuff. Continuing. Here's your World 4 Fortress. This is where you first encounter the Hot Foot, which are those little walking fireballs. World 4's underwater level. Oh, there's somewhere you can get a Tanuki suit here. Yeah, it turns Mario into a statue, which makes you invulnerable temporarily. Yeah, there it is. There's a secret for how to get it right over there. Let's see. Let's keep going, huh? Let's keep going. World 4-6. Man, that autofocus just drives me bonkers. I hope you guys are okay with it. Fortress of the Hidden Quarter. A switch block will open the way to a hidden quarter of the fortress, which gives you a chance to gain some extra coins and, of course, one-ups, plus some extra practice with pipe maze tactics. Huh. There it is. Oh, right. You jump on these guys, and as you jump on them, they change direction. I believe the ones with arrow symbols on them will only go one way, and the ones with an exclamation point can be changed. Right, confirmed right here, yeah. Oh, Mario's bonking his head. Silly, silly boy. Here's the World 4 airship, which has Iggy. I think Iggy was always my favorite design of Koopaling. I love his wild colored hair and his glasses and his kind of like crazy looking eyes. Like, that's a good Koopa. The king in this one, let me see, what is it? He's like a little lizard. That's cute. He's a little lizard. And the reward, which is really useful in the next stage, is a P-Wing, thank God. Oh, here's a fun thing. If you're wearing a suit, like one of these three special suits, when you save a king, he says something funny. I think if you're wearing the hammer suit, he asks you for it. And if you don't give it, he says, no dice. What a drag. World 5, Sky World. Mario's... Mario just escaped a very bad fate by fireball there. Careful, buddy. And you've got the fire chomp and the parabeetles. They kind of look like candy that you want to chomp into one of those guys. Anyway. So 5-1 starts on the ground. The fun thing about this stage, I mean this whole world, is that you start on the ground and then halfway through you go up into the clouds. So the whole world ascends upward, which is really cool. So here we've got this weird structure here. You've got some chain chomps. You've got some one-ups, as you can see right there. Fly to the sky pipe. Oh, yeah, one of those pipes that you have to get using your raccoon suit. Raccoon leaf or raccoon tail. Here we've got... let's see. Oh, 5-2, yeah, this one's great because you fall down this pipe and there's a free fall and you gotta catch all these coins on the way down. Buster Beetle. Is this where you first meet Buster Beetle? Yeah, it's real satisfying to It's real satisfying to like exchange blows with that guy. Let's see. Oh my god, 5-3 guys, 5-3. You see that? 5-3. 5-3 is the best stage in the entire game. There's some essay, I think it's called Life Non-Warp, about Mario 3, that goes into great detail about why 5-3 is so special. But 5-3 is really so, so special. You really get to make the most out of it. Like 5-3, it wants you to play it. It wants you to enjoy it. You kind of just want to linger there for a while. You wish you could take that shoe with you. Because you hop in and you're basically invincible. You bounce around. It's real satisfying. You can hop on things that would normally kill you. And when it's over, you just feel robbed. Because it never comes back again for the rest of the game. It's weird. It's like its rarity is what makes it so special. And if the game was overfilled with it, maybe it wouldn't be so special. But the fact that you have to go through all this work to get halfway through the game, a little over halfway through the game, just to get that shoe, man. Like, what a treat. What a special treat. There's a World 5 fortress. Once you beat this fortress, you go up into the sky, and that's great. So yeah, there's a lower level to the fortress. Oh wait, am I confused? No. You beat the fortress and then you go to the tower. The tower is where you ascend to the sky. So the tower connects the two. It starts off kind of looking like a fortress. It's almost like Castlevania-esque with all these columns. I do love this checker pattern floor. I love the way it sort of curves off into the horizon a little bit. It's really a really nice design. You've got these parapets just made out of bricks. You ascend this pipe over here. There's like chandeliers hanging from the ceiling. Another really nice touch. Just these quaint little design touches that make this game so special. And there we are. Hop up this vine, up into this guy, and you are in the clouds, my friend. Continuing on. Let's see. Is this an auto-scroller level? Maybe it is. There's an auto-scroller level that's just absolute trash. There it is, 5-6. 5-6 is the... Oh, God. Okay. Yeah, so... This is the level that will... if you've got a fear of falling, if you've got like a... If you've got acrophobia, if you have acrophobia, this level is gonna, like, drive you bonkers. First, there's this level with the donut platforms that wiggle a little bit and then fall. And then you've got this parabeetle stage where you have to be real careful. 5-7, I don't recall much about it. Oh god, yes, right. And 5-4, with these spinning platforms. These platforms that just go all crazy and spinning and they just send you flying off. You guys, these three levels, 5-4, 5-5, and 5-6, are just so nerve-wracking. Oh my god. Oh, and here. Here we see one of those little white blocks. Let's you know that there's a secret here. A little secret. 5-4. Level 5 fortress. Lava everywhere. Very cool. But again, very nerve-wracking. 5-8. A cloud stage with a Lakitu chasing you around. And then 5-9, that's the one I'm thinking of. 5-9 is the auto scroll that goes up and up, and these fire chomps chase you around. It's so funny that the best stage in the entire game is like it's like an appetizer to a really terrible meal, because all the rest of World 5 is just absolute nightmare fuel. It's so difficult. Like, it's so hard. It's so hard, you guys. You have no idea. Oh, I mean, maybe you do, because this game's been around since almost 30 years now. Lord. The World 5 airship. It's very metallic. There's these big wall-mounted cannons. You get a feeling that this thing is armed to the teeth. And then there's cool Roy with his cool shades. Roy is so cool. He's so much cooler than you. Don't you wish you were as cool as Roy Koopa? You do. But you're not. And yeah, he stomps around for a while. That's a... Man. That battle is a little difficult, too. And just everything about the stage. Once you're done, you're relieved. The king in this world has been transformed into a little birdie. And you save him and you get a Jugo's Cloud. Jugo's Cloud is great if you want to skip a level. But if you're sent back, like let's say you have to chase the Air Fortress. And if you die in the Air Fortress and you got to go chase it down. And you don't have that cloud anymore, you got to play the level. Here's World 60, Obligatory Ice World. Also known as Winter Wonderland. Which I just thought it was called Iceland, but apparently it's Winter Wonderland. You've got all these guys frozen in ice. You can break them out with fireballs. You've got Tanuki Suit Mario jumping over that spiky ball, which our friend Spike here is throwing. They let you know right off the bat you're going to be slipping around on this ice. There was an ice world in Mario 2. It's World 4. But in Mario 3, it's World 6. Not a lot to say here. Just some secrets. It's just a slippery ice world. You know, that's all it is. It's less compelling than World 5. Ooh, I do like this. You have to ride this ice block over lava, then over spikes, and then down and hop off at the end to get in that door. That's really cool. What else? Yeah, see, it's not very memorable for some reason. It's just an ice world. You got this, like, underground lake, which is really cool. That's really cool. Kind of hop in here now. Physics would let us know that this is impossible. This would in real life, this would drain because it's like an aquifer. This would drain and it would fill up into here, but you know, this is a game, so who cares. Ooh, another donut platform world. Very stressful. And at the end, if you have your firepower, you can melt all these blocks and get the cool coins. Isn't that fun? Here's our ice fortress with a lot of horizontal thwomps. That's stressful because you gotta kind of beat him up there. Let me scoot that over. See this guy? He comes at you through this channel here. And you gotta do a lot of dodging. And of course it's ice, so it's slippery. World 6-8, you're out of the ice. It's just another grass world. Oh, there's a P block you can hit, fly up, and turn all these blocks into coins. That's so wicked. And then you've got a couple Buster Beetles over here waiting to trash you, I think. Yeah. Continuing. They're saying you should use a frog suit in this level. I will take their word for it. Exchange munchers for money. Oh, it's a P switch that turns munchers into coins. That's kind of neat. Oh yeah, this one. There is. Oh right, I said that this was not a memorable world, but this level is very memorable because you've got all these munchers frozen in blocks of ice. So if you want these coins, you can kind of shoot at them with a fireball, but if you're not careful, you know, you'll reveal the munchers underneath. It's a very ominous sort of setting, isn't it? There's a third fortress in World 6. God, there's so many fortresses. Why? This is a good fortress. It's very spooky. There's a lot of these stretches. Which makes it difficult because they like to pop their little heads up. We've got the World 6 Air Fortress, which has probably the most of all the Koopaling battles, the most fun one, which is Iggy's, and he's throwing little bouncy balls around at you. Oh, Iggy. Yeah. Lemmy, sorry. Did I say Iggy? I meant Lemmy. There's a Hammer Brothers suit in this world. Is that true? Oh, that's cool. The World 6 King has been transformed into a sea lion. And if you rescue him, you get a well-deserved P-Wing. World 7 Pipe Maze. This is the hardest. World 8 is tough, but World 7 is hands down the toughest world in the entire game. It's so brutally difficult. And it feels a bit meta, doesn't it? Like, hey, you guys know Mario. Mario is all about pipes. Well, guess what? We've got all the pipes you could ever need or want. You like sewers, don't you, plumber? You like sewers? Well, we got sewers for you. There's sewers. Come down to the sewer. Come get your sewer. All right. So, welcome to Tube City. Oh, my goodness. Look at this climb. Oh, God. That's painful just to look at. You're going to use all your stinking items trying to get through this world. And you're not going to have anything left for World 8 because, God, there's just so much. So after this skyscraper's worth of a level, you go to this hideous maze of garbage. In and out of pipes, up and down. You'll need the frog suit speed. Yeah, this is a great level for the frog suit because you're just constantly going around. World 7... 3, it just looks like a lot of slipping and sliding. Oh, that's pretty cool. Oh, there's a Lakitu. Get out of here. What else? 7-4, a water level. Oh, is this... Oh, a Gelectro maze. Is that what I'm seeing there? What am I seeing? Yes. Yeah, that's a Gelectro maze. Which are just brutal. And we've got, let's see, 7-5, more pipes, more getting lost. What's going on here? Giant piranha plant. There's a big piranha plant on the map, which represents a world infested by different types of piranhas. Use a star man at the start of the stage. Cover as much ground as possible. If you get through that world, you get a P-Wing. That's a good prize. Yeah, God, this whole world is tough as nails. There's a second giant piranha plant, too, later on. Just munchers coming up and down out of the pipes. Oh, God. Oh, don't love it. The Abandoned Fortress. Ooh, that sounds spooky. The only inhabitant of this fortress is Boom Boom. The tube to his room is the ceiling of the big deserted chamber with the checkerboard floor. Oh, that's creepy. What happened? Did everybody eat? Muncher Mania. Oh my God. Look at that. That is such a cool level. It's like... you have to keep getting stars as you go along, or else you'll get murdered. Oh, my Lord. It's like the game is really throwing everything at you. And that's after this World 7-6 is the worst level in the world, because you've got to keep going up these little platforms, up and up and up and up and up. These vertical levels... they're really difficult. This game just ruins you. Fire flower infestation. I don't know if I'd call fire flowers an infestation. It's a gift. World 9-7, a different type of pipe maze. Another frustrating one, because you always want to get in here, and sometimes it's just hard to do. If you lose your raccoon tail, you're just... that's it. You're just going to have to skip it. Like, skip all the cool stuff, all the cool coins and stuff. Oh, this fortress. This fortress can be a real terror. There are lots of piranha plants, swamps, boo diddlies, and roto discs. Precise jumping is essential. Wear a Hammer Brothers suit if possible. Yeah, waste your perfectly good Hammer Brothers suit on this level. They say that because there's a lot of fire piranha plants. God, it's like I'm having flashbacks of this world. The World 7 airship, very sparse. You've got these rotating bolts and nut setups. So you jump on the nut, and it spins as you jump on it, and you have to rotate it to the end of the bolt. Oh my god. It's so easy to fall to your death there. There's Ludwig with his cool blue hair. He's so cool. It's white in the game because of graphical limitations, but his hair is supposed to be blue. This king has been transformed into a piranha plant. You don't get a prize. You get a message from Bowser letting you know that he has the princess. Ha, ha, ha. And now you get to World 8. There's the World 8 art. There's Bowser shooting a cannon directly at Mario's crotch. Sorry, buddy. Yeah, I'd be sweating too if I were you, friend. So the reason I said that World 7 is harder than this one is because there are a lot of ways you can sort of cheat your way through this world. There is this armada right here in the first world of these little like wooden log tanks. There's a lot of Monty Moles. And it's never a problem if you have a P-Wing. You save all your P-Wings so that you can just fly over this. World 8-2 is a bunch of like warships, also made out of logs. I love that all of Bowser's, his entire like army, navy, air force, it's all made out of logs. But you just put on the frog suit and you just swim underneath through this orange water and you're fine. You come to this bridge here where these hands come out, and as illustrated here, just kind of pluck Mario and drag him into the level, sort of. So the tile, you don't interact with it unless a hand comes out. And these are like a series of bridges, like bridge levels. Some of them have Cheep Cheep, some of them have these like Sledge Brothers. They're not particularly difficult, and you get a cool prize at the end. Inventory buffer. Koopa's Air Force. Oh, if you don't have a P-Wing for this level, you are in for a difficult time, although it is pretty doable with a raccoon leaf. I feel like 9 times out of 10 I have to play this level with a raccoon leaf because I like to save my P-Wings for later if I still have any left. Finally, a normal world. Yes, thank God. It's just like a standard sort of world, but the colors are all inverted. It's all black backgrounds, white outlines. It's very visually pleasing to look at. World 8-2, there's some quicksand that you can sort of sneak through to get ahead. There is an angry sun, funny enough, that chases you around in this level. This part is really difficult to get through. You gotta bounce around on these blocks, and I feel like it's just easy to sort of miss that super jump and fall to your death there. Let's see, what else? What else, friends? Oh, this fortress. I always get lost in this fortress. This is probably the most difficult level in this world, as far as I'm concerned, because you just get lost. Like, they ask you here, so how do you get to Boom Boom? With all these secret doors, you might have guessed that the exit is also hidden. Hit the switch block and skip the door on the conveyor. The door on the small ledge to the extreme right leads to Boom Boom. Once you enter, squat under the spikes and take him out. So yeah, you gotta hit this switch. You go all the way over to the far wall, and there's a little red door that you have to enter, just propped up on this ledge here. There's one more tank level. This one is super tanks. It's about the same difficulty as the other tank level. It's an auto scroller, like the other two ones, like the first tank level, warship level, and the Air Force level. Those are all auto scrollers, and they just plod along. All these vehicles sort of make their way through. I really love, I love how at the end of these stages there's a little pipe just on a platform. That's a very satisfying way to end one of those stages. So then our last stage is Bowser's Fortress. These statues that shoot lasers at you, they're real freaky, and they kind of make me think of, there's a scene in Neverending Story where Atreyu has to get past like statues that have laser eyes, and it always reminded me of that. I like how Mario's sort of gearing up. You know, it looks like he's doing this motion that's typically for rolling up your sleeve, like you're gonna get in a fight, but he's not rolling up his sleeve. He's just sort of like grabbing his own arm, like as if to say, "I would be rolling up my sleeve if I wanted to, but I don't want to because I want to keep my shirt on." But yeah, look at the resolve on his face. You get him, buddy. You get him. And there's the king of the Koopas himself, old Bowsy. And they like to save the ending. They like to keep it a secret for you because it's really special to get to the end of the game and to see that last boss battle with your own two eyes. They do that in the Legend of Zelda instruction manual. They did that in the last video where we were looking at Castlevania 3 guide for... Castlevania 3. Yeah, Castlevania 3 guide. So, yeah. The last fight with Bowser, which you've probably seen, you're in sort of a bowl of bricks, and Bowser's trying to smash you, and he keeps smashing through layer after layer of the floor and shooting fireballs at you. And the last one he does, he breaks through the floor and falls to his apparent death. So anyway, there's our cool guy holding his rolled up issue of Nintendo Power at the end there, just to let you know that you could save big right now on a subscription to Nintendo Power magazine. That guide art is not official. That must be like a mock-up. And that's the end, folks. Wasn't that fun? Isn't that a great book? This is like one of the most special pieces of Nintendo memorabilia ever made. Don't miss these information-packed guides. Star Tropics gives you maps, strategies, tips, and more to help you meet the challenges of this huge exotic world of adventure. Final Fantasy provides maps, clues, and all the tools you need to make this the ultimate role-playing adventure. I don't recall a Star Tropics guide. Did they ever release an official Star Tropics guide? I don't know. Anyway, that's it, folks. Thanks for hanging out. And we'll see you next time. Bye-bye.